all here on behalf of the Archaeology Audience Network, I call it the AAN for short. It's a two-year initiative funded by the Department for Digital, Culture, Media and Sport, DCMS, and the National Lottery through the Heritage Fund's Digital Skills for Heritage initiative. So the AAN is a collaboration between archaeological groups in England working to bring together, learn from, and improve our use of data about audiences in order to achieve more meaningful impacts with those audiences and for archaeology more generally. So the collaborators in the network right now include MOLA, ourselves, the Archaeology Data Service based at the University of York, the Council for British Archaeology, Dig Ventures, Oxford Archaeology, Wessex Archaeology, and York Archaeological Trust, alongside a series of supporters from different professional and academic bodies. The network launched a couple of months ago, and we aim for it to grow over time and to eventually become self-sustaining when our formal 2 years of funding comes to an end in spring 2023. Before we delve into the nitty-gritty of the network's activities, so to date, I wanted to do a bit of Zoom etiquette. Firstly, we were asked, would like to ask if you could update your Zoom name if it's not in this form already by including your first name, your organization or affiliation if you identify with one, and any pronouns that you might want us to use. You make that change by clicking on the three little dots next to your image. I was going to say I'll do it. I do have to do it myself because this is a new one. So as I'm speaking, I'm going to do that. I've clicked on the three dots. There's a rename button, and I'm entering that in right now. If you're willing to do the same, that would be awesome. You should have joined in mute mode. If I could ask you to put yourself in mute if you're not right now, that would be great, and keep it on mute unless when others are speaking. We're going to use the chat for questions, observations, any clarifications that you want to have while others are presenting. You can raise your hand by pressing the raise hand button if you want to ask questions verbally. And to engage in discussion during facilitated discussions, or you can just use the chat if you prefer not to raise your hand and speak aloud. You can feel really free to have your camera off. No need to feel like you need to have it on. You can stretch, move about, and do whatever you need to do to and enable you to participate. No expectations for the camera to be on. Magnus is tell us how to do live captioning, turn the live captioning on if you want. So Magnus, what do we do?
If you look at the band of options at the base of the slide that Sarah is sharing at the moment, you'll have amongst them an option that says live transcript CC. And if you click on that option, you're able to either show subtitle, which will put subtitles across the screen sharing area whilst we're talking, or you can click on view transcript, and that'll open up the full transcript of the event on the right hand side. And that allows you to see who is talking. It's not 100% accurate, actually. But we'll give you more of an impression of who is talking as well.
Thanks, Magnus. So we're going to be recording, and we already are recording this first half of the session. The second part, we won't keep it on record because it's meant to be more interactive and focused on safe and open sharing of ideas. And with that in mind, Chatham host rule applies there, meaning that please feel free to share the information that you take on board during that time, but please do not share the identity or affiliation of those from whom that information has been imparted. Last thing I wanted to mention is that we are following the code of conduct of Cobb and Croucher, what they've used for their teaching and learning in archaeology and heritage events, which are based on those from the Society of Postmedieval Archaeology. The brief version of this is that we do not tolerate any form of harassment. If it appears like harassing behavior is taking place. We will identify that behavior. We will ask you to stop.
Hi. So there is an awful lot on today's agenda, so I will whistle through this rather than rehearsing every point. We are going to spend the first part of the session reviewing research into archaeology audiences to date, what kinds of data that we've been drawing together as part of the Archaeology Audience Network project thus far, and what we've learned from it. And then after that, we want to hear from all of you all in the Zoom room via Padlet on your impressions of that data, and also kind of what you need of audience data to do the archaeological work you do. Once we've done that, we will take an all-important screen break, and we'll come back from that just to share any queries and observations. Next slide, please. Then moving on from that, I'll lead us through a hands-on activity, again, using Padlet quite heavily to help us think about designing activities for audiences who might experience barriers to participation. And that's based very much on our professional experience. We'll take another screen break in the middle of that and come back to complete it and reflect on it. And then we'll take a final screen break before revisiting our initial Padlet to think about the kind of gaps, surprises, or potentials of audience data sets having been through the exercise. There'll be a bit of a wrap-up session, opportunities for you to ask questions throughout, and then we'll tell you a bit about next steps. Thank you. So if we go on to the next slide here, I just wanted to share a little bit about the kind of goals of the Archaeology Audience Network. Again, I won't rehearse everything here, but the fundamentals of what we're trying to achieve are an archaeology data service guide to good practice for audience data. You know, that will point towards standard evaluation criteria, and the more to a degree standardized our evaluation criteria are, the more we're able to make arguments for doing more archaeology that go beyond individual projects. We want to bring together audience data in a usable format that anyone can access and use to identify potential audiences for their archaeological deliveries. The named partners in the project will be developing pilot projects in 2022, which will explore the application of this data to developing new modes of practice. And we want to be developing community of skills and a community of practice around designing for audiences, which we'll do through the 7 training sessions, of which this is the very first. So thank you for getting in on the ground floor. Today, we're going to look at particularly at points 2 and 4. So Sara will take us through some points on the data set. And then we'll be sharing kind of research ideas and skills in designing archaeological programs and thinking critically about the data we need to collect around them. So we've left our topics for our subsequent training sessions largely open. They'll be delivered by our partners in the Archaeology Audience Network. And we do want these to be responsive to the needs of the sector and our findings as they emerge. And so there will be quite a lot of asking questions of you in this session. So please do feedback if you feel able to. It will help us to deliver a better project. So I will pass you back then to Sara to talk about work to date on AAN.
Thanks, Magnus. Magnus and Simona, if there are questions or anything, can you just interrupt and I'll focus now on going through some of the slides to get us into the hands-on activities. So I was going to start by just making sure we're all on the same page about what we mean or what I mean when I'm using the word audience data. This was something we agreed when we were putting together the application to the National Lottery and DCMS for our funding. We're talking about demographic, attitudinal, perception-based, and other outcomes-based data about individual people that are engaging with archaeological activities. So that means things like how people have gained, or if people have gained new knowledge, developed new skills, changed their attitudes and perceptions, whether they've experienced improved well-being, whether they felt empowered or bonded with others through the work. It can cover many other things, environmental, economic, and social, from participating in archaeological work. I think it's worth noting that it always doesn't have to be positive outcomes either. They could be more complicated, and the data should help us to be able to reflect on negative effects as well. And a really exciting example of work that's going on in this domain is Sierra McKinney's PhD research into guilt and shame that is generated by a heritage engagement. So that's something for all of us to keep our eyes on. I have a slide here about why are we doing this work right now. I mean, it builds on a very, very huge array of data collection activities and calls for more focus on audiences that has been going on for decades and now, so don't claim to be doing something new, but there's a reason for us to really start consolidating this work right now, and lots of ways to answer the question why now. I wanted to draw your attention just to a couple of points. Engagement with public audiences really does continue to grow in archaeology. The vast majority of archaeologists who self-described as working in public archaeology are employed professionals, mostly funded via development-led projects. So looking into the practices and impacts of development-led work on people is important. MOLA alone reaches at least 16,000 individual people per year via our programs. And this doesn't include digital reach, which has surpassed hundreds of millions of people this year already. The scale, therefore, is tremendous when you factor in all of the other organizations and individuals who are delivering archaeological activities to the public in different ways and in different venues and forums. All of this work is funded in different ways, but it's worth saying that only 5% comes from community-based sources like the National Lottery, and only 3% from other public bodies like universities. And there hasn't been much change in this trend around funding for the last 10 years. Charitable grant giving for community-based archaeological projects pre-pandemic makes up a tiny proportion of all the grants that are given out. This funding is linked to evidencing of impact and broadening of audiences, and is increasingly data-driven. So for those of us applying for these grants, proficiency with impact data is crucial to success in winning and also to testifying to outcomes. And then beyond funding and reach, our lack of attention to data is something that many have explicitly called out. And I've just included a quote there from Gabe Moshenshka, where he talks about the paucity of data is probably the greatest single barrier to future developments in public archaeology. As I mentioned, there's a lot of existing research on this subject matter. I've listed a few of them here. Lots of public opinion polls, various professional opinion polls, meaning the perceptions of archaeologists themselves about public archaeology. A couple of surveys of people, so meta-analyses, including the Cultural Heritage Counts for Europe work of 2015. A variety of work on visiting trends and on wider cultural participation in the UK taking part in heritage counts are perhaps the best known and most consistent. A variety of media specific surveys looking at TV viewing audiences, web and social media users, news readers, fieldwork publications, and then of course project specific examples. And I've put a link there We've shared the slides already. I think Simona was going to drop the link to the slides again. All the slides have hyperlinks to the actual references, so you should be able to follow along and click on them. I put one there to Crown Boom's work on sociocultural impacts of public activities in archaeology, which is particularly robust. The main things that I wanted to point out about this is that there, one might suggest that there's an inclination in all of this work towards general opinion polls disconnected from the actual real life outcomes of archaeology on people, an inclination towards heritage as opposed to archaeology specific, a focus on visitor trends as opposed and visiting trends as opposed to hands-on engagement, participation and activities. And a focus on professional opinions and experiences as opposed to wider non-specialist audiences. There are a couple of, there's a variety of different studies that go into more depth about specific audiences. And I wanted to highlight the report that Frierson did for the CBA a couple of years ago. It's worth noting that this particular survey, which collected about 690 valid responses, had no one under the age of 16 responded, and hence data do not reflect the experiences of younger age groups. But the profile we see here from Frierson's work in analyzing the surveys, which to give you the highlights or lowlights, as I think that we should probably call them, is that there's very little diversity in audiences participating in community archaeology and in the offerings for those audiences. And those findings are echoed in some of the other surveys that I demonstrated or have links to on the previous slide. So what are some of the things to take away from Frierson's report? The vast majority of audiences, 93% are over 30 years old, with a significant proportion over 61 years old. 96% identify as white British in comparison to the actual population of 86% white at the 2011 census. More than one in three people identifying as having disabilities and additional needs that we need to acknowledge and cater to. Lots of information about lack of funding, knowledge and equipment that contribute to people not being able to participate, especially leading to non-participation for young people. Significant lack of investment in activities related to archaeology have to do with anything outside of excavation, survey, and health and safety, which has major ramifications for the profession in a variety of ways. And a lot of interest in training, but a lack of digital offerings. Note that this was before the pandemic, and a lack of locally available training opportunities. I'm going to take 1 second just to pause and see if there's any questions or points that people want to broach at this moment. There's a bit more data that I want to supply you related to the work that we've done so far. So we might want to carry on with that, but I'm just going to take 1 second and check Magnus and Simona if there's anything there that I should be attending to.
So we've got a small issue with the link to the Frierson 2018 in the report, and we'll definitely get that tweaked for the follow-up version of the slides, and I'll also pop the link in the chat. And then we do also have a question from Anushka. Is there any geographic variation in the data in terms of age groups engaging with archaeology?
In the, in, if it's with respect to the Frierson report, I think they do, they have a little bit of information about the various areas that people have responded from, but I would have to delve into a little bit more deeply to see if they've analyzed it from that perspective. A lot of the other surveys that I've cited are either national, so they're lumping everybody together, or they're incredibly locally specific. And I think it means that some of the research that's coming out is just basically saying that, you know, what we know from this is everything has to be tailor-made as a result.
Great. So Debbie herself is in the room. She has offered to speak to CBA colleagues to see where it is, but actually Kat from North Somerset has heroically found it and put it in the chat. So thank you.
That's my fault. I clearly just didn't double check it because I was reading it this morning online. So mistake on my part, I'm sorry. Okay, well, let me crack on with talking about some of the work we've done so far with the Archaeology Network. So what we did was we asked our AAN collaborators to supply evaluation reports from up to two recent projects. These could be anything that they consider representative of the type of audience work that they do and that contains typical evaluation data that they collect from audiences. We stripped the data of all personal identifying information and ensured that it conformed with GDPR. I've listed there the various data sets if you want to delve into that in more detail later. We supplied this to the Archaeology Data Service, who did the heroic first effort of going through a lot of this very bespoke and diverse information. They reviewed the data sets in depth. They identified the most common questions and categories of data that were being collected in these various reports and compiled this into Excel tables. They identified a series of challenges that they, and we all have now in interpreting the data in a way that it will allow us to compare them. So different wording of similar questions, different years represented in the data set. So some of them are from COVID times, some are pre-COVID, different approaches to coding and grouping of the data, different issues around how people participated. So some events may have been ones where people had to sign up or register. And so there's a variety of issues there around barriers and potential impediments to participation. They identified gaps in the overall data set, which I'll mention in a second. We haven't been able to delve yet into the data themselves because they aren't in a position for us to truly compare them. So that's something to be warned of. We can't say much about what data are actually telling us right now because you're still grappling with categories of data. What can we say? Data gives us two different perspectives from that of the like so-called end user, the participant, and also those who are engaging with groups that are engaging the end user, the participant. We can see 14 general categories of common data that are always being collected by network collaborators. I've listed them here. We can see that demographic data predominate here, and I'll get into some specifics about why we need to be a bit concerned about these demographic data in a moment. And we can see that organizations tend to have one of three focuses, the last one being the least common. So they are either evaluating, they meaning we, are either evaluating the experience or the event itself, trying to understand how we can support or train others that that are delivering events and experiences, or are actually trying to understand the audience and their abilities. What you can see on your screen right now is the 10 most common questions that were being asked that the ADS drew out of the data sets. And note that not all of these questions were being asked by everyone. The most commonly asked question is how old people are. And then the other questions are perhaps not ones that we'd be that surprised about, asking about gender. A couple, not many, ask about ethnicity. Several ask about postcodes. Most ask about motivation for engagement. Some interested in repeat participants. Some interested in where they've heard about information about the event. Some asked for feedback on things. Some wanted people to talk about what the highlight of their experience was. And some were asking for descriptions of what activities they participated in. What are the many, many questions that arise as a result of this? I'm going to be speaking very candidly here and can speak about it from the position of MOLA, because all of these points apply to our own the gaps in our own organizational data, but it's not only MOLA that is responsible in this way. Most people are collecting incredibly basic demographic information and not looking at other audience needs information around permanent needs, temporary needs, situational data, and we'll talk a bit more about that later. Most outcomes-focused data are not there or are collected very inconsistently, so there's no data on social relationships that are created through public archaeology activities. No information about conversations started or listening that was taking place during the activities. Very rarely was there data being collected about emotional outcomes beyond enjoyment. Some do ask about confidence or excitement or amazement, more complex emotional reactions like confusion or anger or shame or care aren't being collected. No data collected about presence, so the feeling of actually being present in the historical period that's the focus of the work, or being affected by the presence of others, although there was one organization was asking about whether participants enjoyed the company of others. And Jorvik was asking about the impact of their guides on the experience of the participant, which maybe you could infer relates to presence. No data being collected about environmental impacts, or about distance traveled where there were physical in-person activities happening. Very few data being collected about web or social media use or access. There was a lack of consistent use of existing evaluation, outcome, value, or impact frameworks between and across organization, and a lack of, I guess I would suggest that this lack of outcomes data and lack of use of existing frameworks means that therefore we have a gap between the values that are being identified as linked to archaeology in opinion polls and the values that we can see coming out in policy documents talking about the importance of archaeology and the actual data that we're collecting about public archaeology activities. So I will, Magnus always gives me a hard time for focusing on the negatives. So I'll just end this by saying, obviously there's still a lot of value in doing this work because we're learning from it. We knew that there were going to be a huge number of gaps in, and that these gaps would teach us something. And that the value of collecting on our own terms here and then reviewing that gives us, it's an opportunity for growing and development. So I'm conscious that I've gone a little bit over time, and I think we should probably take the break that we're all due so we can digest some of that information. I'll come back to the to an activity. Welcome back, everyone. We We're conscious that the audience here today includes a really wide variety of people, some who I think may have a tremendous amount of experience in data collection, some who are aspiring to do this kind of work, some who may not know where to start or may not have resources or time to do it, some who might just be interested in the topic and have popped along for the information and conversation. So we'd like to engage in, or have the opportunity to engage in a discussion of some of the observations that you might have about the data that we've just presented, but also ensure that everybody can comment in their own way, even if they've never done evaluation before. So we've created this Padlet that you can see on my screen here. It's in the chat. And if you do not have access to the link, please can you either raise your hand or make a note in the chat and we'll reshare the link again. The Padlet has these six questions on it, and we hope that each of these questions will allow you to be able to enter or contribute to the conversation in some way. What you do with Padlet is click on this little plus button, which features underneath each question, and you can add your own thoughts, examples, etc. You can see it happening in real time as people are doing it right now. When you click on the button, it brings up a little box. It allows you to add a subject heading if you want, write some more text underneath, you can attach a document if you want, a photograph, a link, etc. I'm going to read through the six questions and give you a couple of minutes to add to it. And then we'll have a second to reflect on it and then move into some other work. So the first question is one maybe seems like an obvious one, maybe it's not. Why would you or do you evaluate audience experiences and impact? The second question is, what might stop you from doing that kind of evaluation work? Third question, for those that maybe are doing it already, what kind of existing evaluation criteria or frameworks or benchmarks are you using to make your evaluation data comparable across your organization or with others? And I've put one example there of the generic social outcomes that I know some use for this framing of their own approach. What specific outcomes or permanent, temporary, situational audience needs do you collect around your audience? So permanent, temporary, situational is going beyond general demographic information to understand day-to-day life circumstances that might affect you related to whether you've broken your arm that day, whether you've lost a family member and that's impacting on your ability to operate in the world, whether you have particular religious needs or language needs that affect your ability to participate. Fifth question is about skills you feel you need to develop in order to increase your capacity for our audience evaluation. And final point is about other questions that, in the best case scenario, if we can answer every question in the world, what are the questions we haven't been asking that you'd like us to focus on? I'm going to stop speaking for a second. There might be some hands up. I'll let Magnus and Simone and let me know if I need to acknowledge those and otherwise have a look at what's coming through.
No hands up at present, but do feel free, folks. You have a little option in the reactions, under the reactions tab at the base of your screen to raise a hand. And if so, you know, we can ask you to unmute and everybody gets to hear a voice that's neither mine nor Sarah's.
Excellent. Lots of interesting. Who we aren't reaching and non-participant information. Yes, this point about often too preoccupied with evaluating the impacts of our work and the outcomes rather than studying the audiences themselves. And that's something that definitely was coming up in some of the other surveys that have been distributed or critiques of those surveys.
Equally interesting, I think, given how digital we are being this evening, this point about needing skills training in non-digital evaluation, so capturing the data or feelings of people in a non-digital way at engagements.
Yeah,
I think this was, it's definitely one that's speaking to me right now.
I was looking at that too, and this other, there's the question here about composing, or point here about composing questions, is something that you and I, Magnus, have talked a lot about in understanding sort of the comparability of the different questions that are being asked and how the questions are being phrased in order to solicit the responses and the engagement that we were hoping for. Thanks, all. This document is one that we're going to return to later on as we get a bit further into the session, and unless we want to, Magnus, you want to reflect on anything else, I might pass it over to you.
I think for now, just for the sake of time and finishing in reasonable time, we ought to press on, but there will be an opportunity to come back to this.
Great.
Everyone, for your contribution so far.
The link stays active, so I'm just going to stop sharing my screen and share the slides for Magnus now. So.